My aim is to give you an overview on commercially available equipment and to describe how EUS and EUS guided biopsy is performed. So, which endoscopes are we using? Ultrasound processors, needles, and other accessories. And how is EUS procedure with EUS F&A and F&B performed? I will excuse a little if some of you think, oh, he forgot this and this. There might be other equipment out there that I really didn't think of. I tried to get everything in my lecture. So first, ultrasound scanners and EUS endoscopes. Olympus has both an integrated unit, which is integrated in the endoscopic platform, and they have also a standalone possibility together with Hitachi and Aloka. Their endoscopes is ranging from radial scanning, linear curved array, electronic transducer technology, even a straightforward viewing for therapeutic use, and their lateral scanning, linear scanning, EUS for EUS F&A, and this is for EBUS TBNA. And there is also a mechanical rotating transducer mainly used, but also used in GI, but also in pulmonology. I would say to mention quality of images, there is a difference between a integrated system and a standalone system. Pentax has also electronic array, radial scanning, the regular EUS F&A endoscope, as you can see here, and they have a slimline endoscope. Each of these have different, qualities and uses. We will get further into this. Lately, there is a complete new line, and this is commercially available right now. We had hoped to show you that, but there has been some problems with the washing machines, which are the types that we have has to have a connector, and it has not been possible to create such a connector at this time, but I have seen it, and the images are really nice. The transducer is smaller, and the biopsy channel is 4 millimeters, so a bigger biopsy channel for therapeutic use as well. The scanners that I use is mainly Hitachi, but I also think that Aloka can be coupled to this. This is the Arrieta scanner. There's a wide range of scanners that you can buy in different prices, but Arrieta is one of them, which is a high-end scanner. Fujifilm has an integrated system, and also the same range of endoscope, electronic radial scanning, the curved array echo endoscope, I think that's it. Coming to needles and other accessories. On the market you have standard needles, which is 19 gauge, 22 gauge, and 25 gauge. And there are different players on the market: Olympus, Cook, Boston, Mediglobe, Medtronic, and there are a few others, I think MTV also. But basically, you can get them with or without a round stylet or a beveled stylet, as you can see here. I would say, if you are a beginner, I would prefer a round stylet because you might damage the endoscope if you don't take care with a beveled stylet. There are differences in sheaths, there are differences in needle tips, and many of the companies have Teflon or plastic sheaths. The attempt to make needles more clearly visible is different from company to company. This is the Mediglobe, as you can see, a big, very, very long, sharp tip. Boston also pretty long, and Cook a little shorter. But again, these changes made on the metal looks different from. But this is also seen on ultrasound, as you can see here. Some are seen in total length, others are seen in only a small part of it, and some are seen as only a small tip, and then the rest comes after that. Boston Scientific needles are called Expect. They have a slim line and normal more other view than the slim line. Most of their needles are of course FNA needles, but they also have the Acquire, which is an FNB needle looking like that. It's the Acquire 22 gauge, 25 gauge is made of cobalt chromium. Most of the other needles are made either of steel, and some are made of nitinol. This 19 gauge needle is made of. The 19 gauge needle is made of nitinol. This is the Expect Flex needle, cobalt chromium. Olympus has S-shot. EUS FNA and recently an FNB needle as well. The standard needles are covered with Teflon sheath, as you can see here, standard needles. All needles work similar, and I must say the quality is very good, whatever you choose of needle. I think they are very similar. They are small differences, and it is most personal preference, I think, that would lead you to your choice of needle. The new FNB needle from Olympus is a sharp cut needle, but according to their saying, this takes very good histological material. They have the needles also with a hole in it, but apparently what they say is that the hole needle takes less material than the Mangini type of needle. Mediglobe again has two needle types, Sonotip 2 and Sonotip Pro Control. The Pro Control has control knobs where no matter how it's attached to the endoscope, you can always twist it, whereas sometimes this with this kind of knob can sit in a position where it's a little difficult to handle. What I think Mediglobe has, which is a little different from others, they have also, if you want that, an extended sheath that fits better into a biopsy channel and makes the needle stability, at least this was the idea, more stable. Cook has EcoTip needles, EcoTip Ultra, and EcoTip Pro Core needles, which is an F&B needle. Cook has metal sheath. I forgot to say the F&B needle from Olympus also has a metal sheath. But Cook has a metal sheath in one of their needles, or otherwise I think it's plastic or Teflon sheath. The Pro Core, you can get that as a bevel in the distal part, or a reverse bevel, as you can see here, which is the 20 gauge needle. And we have to see how that works. But the idea is, of course, to, when you move it forward, you cut a piece of the tissue, whereas the other one, when you move it forward and retract it, you cut a piece of tissue. That is the idea. Medtronic, the Beacon FNA and FNB needles, works in a little different way. They have a platform where you can retract the needle itself and place another needle inside the platform that is already introduced in the endoscope. So they have, as you can see, different kind of needles that can be introduced in the platform already sitting on the inlet of the endoscope. And they have, as an F&B needle, as you can see, a coating, an echo-rich coating, and the shark needle. It looks like a shark, and that is why it's called the shark needle. There are also microbiopsy forceps that can go into a 19-gauge needle, as seen here, and take samples. And we will show you also this during our examinations. There are a lot of other accessories, and I will not go into this in details, but there are stent devices, fiducials for radiotactic chemoradiation therapy, RFA probes, access needles from Cook, which has a sharp tip, but this can be withdrawn, and then you have a blunt tip where you can move a guide wire in and out without cutting it. Celiac plexus neuralysis needles and NCLE probes, as seen here, for examination of pancreatic cysts. Lumen opposing metal stents, which the hot axis is very well known. Clever design, I think. But there's also the Spaxius and the Nagi stent, which can be used for drainage procedures. So now coming to US guided biopsy. I'm a little over time, but basically we do that in fastening patients, midazolam or propofol. We use propofol, nurse administered propofol sedation. Lab test only in selected patients, outpatient procedure, and post-procedure observation after biopsy, 1 hour. The biopsy procedure is, you can actually make a step-by-step procedure which is followed every time in order not to make any problems either for your endoscope or the patients. So first of all, it's outlining the lesion, mounting the needle, positioning the needle sheath, introduction of the needle, removing the stylet, aspiration of cytological material with the needle, discontinuation of suction, retraction of the needle tip from the lesion, removal of the needle system, and expelling and smearing of the material. I think that Thomas Huckel will demonstrate all these things to you, what the literature says, but basically there are no difference whether you aspirate or whether you don't, whether you use a stylet, slow pull technique, it's you get the same results. Mounting the needle, I think it's important that your assistant actually keeps a little counter traction Otherwise, you might bend the needle, and if it's not a 19-0 needle, this will bend the metal. It's also very important, I think, that the connector is a metal that firmly connects to the endoscope, because if you, during your needle manipulation, move the needle out, you damage your endoscope. Positioning on the sheet, we do that not controlled by endoscopy, but controlled by ultrasound. So we look at the image and see this is where the sheet is positioned. Not too far out, then you will push the transducer away. So just at the side of the image. Then, of course, you release the piston lock button and introduce the needle, ultrasonically guided. To and fro 5 to 10 times, moving inside the lesion. And try to always do a full needle monitoring. It's not always possible, but try to do it as far as possible. Sometimes you do have to do like a punch technique because the lesions are so hard. You can lift the lesion from below to more convenient for the needle introduction, either by moving the big wheel backwards, that moves this image upwards, but you can also use the elevator, and you can use both of these methods at the same time as well. Look how the hands are held here. I see very young people who start this procedure, they still have the tendency to have this finger put on the air button, but keep it on there so you don't inflate air. It's logical, but it destroys the image. So this is an insufficient biopsy. Look at the needle, it moves a lymph node, but it doesn't move inside the lymph node. I have a hard time to find an insufficient needle pass, and it's an old film, but this is not how you should do it. You see how it moves the lymph node, it doesn't move inside like this. Here you see the needle tip exactly moving into the lesion in a fanning way, as you can see here. Needle tip all the way going in and out. So now we retract the piston and lock it. Please lock it. Otherwise, the needle might be outside and can damage the endoscope. If it is difficult, if the tumor is hard, firm transducer contact with the GI wall, straighten the endoscope, forehand procedures, ask your assistant to push the endoscope a little firmly against the mouth of the patient, and do multiple biopsies. If you want to start this, then there are some difficult cases and there are some easy cases. Don't start with submucosal tumors in the stomach wall. That's so difficult, and they are moving so difficult to get. Pancreatic head tumors from the duodenum is not easy sometimes, but can be very difficult. And if you look at this, start with a large mediastinal tumor, start with a mediastinal lymph node in a straight scope. It's easy to get. Liver lesions is pretty easy, and so on. If difficult, fill the balloon shortly after the needle contact with the duodenal wall, and that gives you a better image. If mountain of biopsy instrument is difficult due to bending of the endoscope in the duodenum, you have to withdraw the endoscope to the stomach and then re-enter to the duodenum. And why not neutralize the elevator after you have caught the tumor? Otherwise, it will only have refriction. It will make more friction to your needle process. So, concluding my talks, EUS scanners and electronic array EUS endoscopes are at present of high quality, I believe. Standalone ultrasound scanners produce better images compared to scanner units integrated in the endoscopic rack. EUS needles are likewise of high quality, and most needles have similar functionality with small differences between them. Choice of needles are often based on personal preferences. Results of EUS-guided biopsy are in many cases closely linked to the experience of the EUS operator. EUS-guided biopsy is a multi-step process: proper indication, technique of biopsy, needle selection, and establishing diagnosis by your pathologist. Thank you for your attention.